I'm Megan Stevens from eatbeautiful.net. Thanks so much for joining me this morning. I come on Periscope every Wednesday at 10:30 Pacific Time, 1:30 Eastern Standard Time. We're getting ready for lunch here. All right, so you're Eastern Standard Time maybe, or Central. Today's topic is my additions to the GAPS diet. I think probably most of you who are tuning in are familiar with the GAPS diet. It is gut and psychology syndrome. It was created by Dr. Natasha Campbell McBride. She developed it based on another diet to heal, called SCD, specific carbohydrate diet, to heal her son of autism. And she is a medical doctor with a lot of education in science. And she wrote this book to educate all of us so that we could, with this book, heal ourselves. She does have a practice, and she does meet with many patients, and it would be just the coolest thing to me if she could write an addition or addendum to this book, or a second edition, updating a lot of this information with what she's learned from her patients over the years. And I recently read a really recent interview with her where it was just so neat to hear that very thing, some of the things she's been thinking about all the years since when she wrote this book. And she is apparently doing some kind of an addition, including topics like lupus, multiple sclerosis, and other autoimmune conditions, and the way she feels that GAPS can help those, which is really cool because right now most people choose AIP who have those conditions. Where is that interview? If you go to my Facebook page and just scroll down like 2 days, you can click on it there. That's the easiest way for me to tell you because I don't actually remember what blog featured the interview. So my Facebook page is Eat Beautiful, and that would probably be the fastest. I would love that too. Yeah, so if you go to the Eat Beautiful Facebook page now, I don't know if you guys have noticed, but they have a new search engine on Facebook. On the top left, there's a search bar, and you can actually type in the word interview or Dr. Natasha Campbell McBride interview, and it will show you all the posts that I've listed on Facebook related to that topic. And I'm sure it'll be the first one, so it'll pop up right to the top. So that's a really cool new search feature. Anyways, yeah, so that article, when you read it, the first bit is just kind of normal. It's a lot of what she has in the book, but as you keep reading the interview, it's quite long. She gets into other topics, which is really exciting. So, and she hits on one of the things I'm going to talk about today. It's actually the first thing. So my emphasis in today's Periscope, and thank you to those of you who are watching later on YouTube, is what would I add to this book if I could share that with more of you? Our family has been on the GAPS diet for 5 years and 2 months, and hello from Brazil. Wonderful, Flavia. So glad to have you. The question is, what would I share with you if I could after having been on the GAPS diet for over 5 years? Now, we're phasing off. I know 5 years is a really long time. We had a lot of issues to deal with. My daughter's asthma, multiple autoimmune conditions, bladder disease, lots more than that. And we've come so far. And one thing she talks about that's really interesting in the recent interview as well as in this book is that she believes some patients will have to be on the GAPS diet for their whole lives. But what's really important to add to that is if that is you or if that is me, we have to modify the diet. We have to be really careful about being on the full GAPS diet with no additions forever because low-carb diets can be dangerous, and I'm going to talk about that. We're in 2 years here. Great. So, all right, let's go ahead and start. And like I said, please feel free to ask questions. If I don't answer a question, please type it again or clarify. I maybe didn't understand it and I was in the middle of another train of thought. This will probably be a two-part talk about GAPS because I don't want to hurry too much. And if you do have questions, I want to be able to answer them. So I'm going to try to go through thoroughly and slowly here. The first one, and again, these are things that I wish that I had known when I was going through GAPS diet the first time. Someone says, I thought I remember her saying from the book that 80% were able to heal completely. I don't actually remember the exact percentage. That sounds about right. Certainly in our experience with our family, we have had a whole spectrum of how well we've done, how well the process has worked on us, and how long it's taken on each of us, and we've healed to different levels. But that's probably pretty accurate. So if she said that and 20% of us need to remain on the GAPS diet for the duration of our lives, we need to first of all find happiness and contentment there, but we also need to be careful and make sure to not be excluding foods that are important for our overall wellness. So some of these things I'm going to share today, or all of them, are things I learned kind of the hard way. And let's face it, she can't see all of us as patients, and I'm just glad she published the book. I certainly wouldn't expect her to have anticipated all of these. I would much rather have had the book and had to figure it out myself than not have had the book. But I really want to be able to share these with you and hopefully save you some time. And heartache maybe too, because some of these things are very important, and if you omit them or don't know about them, they can slow your healing or even damage your wellness. Okay, finally I'm getting to number one. Number one that I wish I had known from the beginning is all about grounding. So I had been on GAPS for about 4 years when I still had pretty extreme adrenal fatigue. I was exhausted, I had no energy, I could not exercise. And I found this doctor in Vancouver, Washington, and he hooked me up to this machine called a biotenant modulator. And I basically felt like a golden retriever when he took me off of this. He put nodes on certain parts of my body that corresponded to my acupuncture or like your meridian, your energy meridian, which I know very little about. But he connected me to certain points, and then he turned the modulator on. He got the setting right. I want to show you one of these. These are like the little patches that he used. The first patch he put on was right up here, right over my esophagus. And even on the very lowest setting, it was extremely painful. And that was because I still had leaky gut after 4 years on the GAPS diet. I could not tolerate it. And I'm very tough. So I was like, I can do it if it's going to, you know, if it's going to be good for me. And he's like, oh no, we'll just move it to a different spot. That's fine. So he would hook me up for about 30 minutes. And each time I would be done, I would feel like I used to feel, you know, 10 years ago or 20 years ago. So I went every week for a while to get these treatments. And that was a little pricey, and he lived a long ways away, so it was not ideal. So when we talked about it further, he talked about the fact that I could get that same kind of grounding, not just from this wonderful machine that had been created, but from nature, by swimming in wild waters, rivers and lakes, safely, of course, or the ocean, by going barefoot on grass, by even putting my feet barefoot on our gravel driveway. And so I started going for walks barefoot every single day. We have a church down below our property with a lot of grass, so I started going for walks. And I found that in the autumn, when the weather changed and there started being water droplets all over the grass, that the effect was like twice as great. So I would walk down from my house, just barely able to walk down with how tired I was. I would get down there and I'd come back like a new person from walking on this grass for about 20 minutes. Then the weather turned even colder. It turned to winter. What was I supposed to do now? Because it was going to be icy and eventually there'd be snow and rain. And that's when I learned about grounding sheets, which I'm sure many of you have already heard about, or other ways of receiving grounding. So we purchased a half sheet, which was for me the most economical choice. It's just a sheet with wires woven through it, very, very fine hair-like wires, very thin. You can't feel them. And then the sheet is plugged in, so you've got this contraption. The sheet is plugged in, and from there it goes to one of two contraptions, either a plug that goes into your electrical outlet if your house is grounded, or this rod is attached to a cord. It can be trailed out your window if you have a window that this would work with, and stabbed into the soil outside of your house. And all of this is getting electrons out of the earth to give you energy. And when I first heard about all of this, I didn't know what to make of it. If you'd like to read more about grounding, I do have a post at eatbeautiful.net. You can read all about my grounding experience and more about the science behind this. But I would just say for me, it was a watershed discovery, and it helped me overcome adrenal fatigue. So it was huge. And what's really cool is in this recent article interview with Dr. Natasha, she actually mentions EMFs and electromagnetic frequencies, like the dangers that come from cell phones and computers and sewing machines and that kind of thing, and the importance of grounding, and with her patients specifically. Someone says, I go barefooted and only wear shoes if I have to. That is wonderful. It really makes a huge difference in our energy levels and our body's ability to heal ourselves. When I went to that doctor for the first time and he diagnosed me, he said my organs were like a dead battery. And I know I was pretty bad off compared to most people, even most people who go on the GAPS diet. So grounding for me made a huge difference, and I continue to sleep on our half sheet every night. I have these patches, which you can put on different spots on your body if you're experiencing pain, or if you want to like use one of the acupuncture points to get into the meridian, your energy meridian. You can sleep with them on, you can put them on while you're working on the computer. There's also grounding pads that you can rest your feet on while you're working on a computer. Is it still an ongoing issue for you if you don't use the grounding? I don't know, because I've gotten so well, and I do actually sleep on the grounding sheet every night. So there was a time we were without it for just a short period, and I always do better with it. So I think it'll probably always be a part of my life, especially when I'm, you know, work on my computer so much of my day and I'm exposed to EMFs and I know my body's vulnerability in this area. I'll probably always, you know, get grounding in one way or another. Okay, so that was number one. Number two is detox baths. And Dr. Natasha does talk about detox baths in her book, but she doesn't go to great lengths talking about them. And again, like I've said, how could she, right? I mean, this would be three times thicker if she expounded on everything. But the thing is, when you first start GAPS, there's a lot to digest. There's a lot of information to implement. And so I just totally overlooked detox baths for years. It was, you know, it's mentioned very briefly in the book. And so I went years without thinking about them, even, you know, really consciously remembering that it was in there. And then it was in rereading the book, which I highly recommend, if you're at any stage in the GAPS diet, at some point going back and rereading it, I found detox baths and going back to read it again. And I was like, oh goodness, this is a missing piece. And indeed, it turned out to be a very important missing piece for me. Like I've said before, there's many different layers of the onion. There's many different keys that help us unlock those layers. And so for me, this was another one that was very important. With the detox baths, I use this. This is a brand new, it's not out of the bag yet. I have another one that I use all the time, but this is a dry brush. It takes me less than 5 minutes. And I have, let's see, if you go to my detox bath article on eatbeautiful.net, I have an article about detox baths, how to do them, how much baking soda or apple cider vinegar to put in, or mineral salts, the essential oils, all the instructions. I also have a link to the video of a woman on YouTube showing you how to do dry brushing. And it's my favorite video. It's very low key and it's very accurate. What's so interesting is when I dry brush, the purpose is you're stimulating your lymphatic system so that your body can take out the trash and expel it. Otherwise, it gets trapped in those lymph nodes and just keeps you unwell. Yeah, the brush, this particular one, by the way, is Bernard Jensen. This was like $7, and a lot of them are more like 9 to 15, but they're not expensive and it's so worth it. I also have a post on my blog about how to wash your dry brush so you don't have to replace it every 3 months. So you can put that into the search engine as well, how to clean your dry brush. But I'll tell you the key points on your body. Your underarms, there's lymph nodes all under here, under your chin, down your neck and your whole upper chest, and then on your bikini line. And when I do my dry brushing, I actually feel a rush. And I've asked my kids, they don't do dry brushing very often, but I have asked them and they say they do not feel a rush. So I think that I need it really badly, and some of you may need it more than others. But I think for me, I've found that the more ways I can assist my body in detoxification, the better. And so when I do this, I usually, like when I'm going under my arm, I'll stroke like 5 times because I can just feel this rush coming every time. And I don't want it to be too little. It's like, let's get that icky stuff out of there. Your body is telling you something. That's exactly right. And I love that connection. I love, you know, A plus B equals C. I can see it working. I can feel it working. And then I get into the tub and I do my detox bath. And again, the instructions for how long to stay in the bath and the purpose of it are in that blog post if you're interested. You can just go to eatbeautiful.net, type into the search engine, detox bath, and push enter, and it should come right up. Okay, the next one I'm going to mention is very much related because, again, we're on this topic of detoxification. And that is the issue of methylation, which basically just means the body's ability to detox. And I wanted to tell you about this supplement, which I don't think you can see it perfectly, but it's a B complex. There's other brands. Seeking Health is my favorite because Dr. Benjamin Lynch up in Seattle is the leading specialist on methylation. You do not have to have what's called the MTHFR gene mutation to have methylation issues or to need a B vitamin or a B complex to assist your body's detoxification. I have found that the lowest dose possible is the best for a lot of people. And so dosage is actually a little bit tricky. And for me, I finally found out that for me, just the lowest amount. So I take one of these a day. But if you can ask your practitioner about B vitamin supplementation for helping with methylation, that would be a great thing to know about and possibly to start. I think a lot of people would benefit from B vitamin supplementation. And that gets on to the next topic, which is really a very potent and interesting one, because even in the new interview with Dr. Natasha, she talks about the importance of someone says methylation, what is that? That's the body's ability to detoxify. So again, it's use of the lymphatic system and its ability to expel toxins and to get you well. In her book and in her recent interview, she talks so much about food and the body's ability to heal itself when we give it the right foods. And even really the importance of de-emphasizing supplements, especially in the intro diet and in the first initial stages of GAPS. And I want to say, yes, of course, she's accurate. She knows more than I do, yes. But I also want to say that experientially, I really, really needed supplements. And she even would say that I think when she works in a clinical setting with her own patients, she absolutely introduces supplements. So what I want to say is please know that. Please don't overemphasize diet for so long that you think supplements are bad because there are so many supplements that are actually key. They are key. They were key to my wellness. They are still key to my wellness, and they will be. And they most likely very well could be key to your wellness also. So to me, the diet is foundational, and nothing else can be built on it as far as making progress if you don't have the diet in place. It's essential. But then there need to be other stones that are built on top of that foundation. And for me, a lot of those stones are supplements. I'm just going to really quickly mention a few. One is D3 plus K2. Again, you have to find the right dosage for you. Ask your practitioner. I love this from Seeking Health again because it combines them both and they are friends holding hands. We need the cofactors. If you're taking D3 and K2, you need to also make sure to be including magnesium oil, which I love this brand. I spray it on my calves before I go to bed at night excuse me, avoid restless leg syndrome. And I also supplement with calcium, which I never thought I would do because when magnesium came into vogue, calcium went out, right? We were all told to not take calcium. But when I worked with my doctor, we found out that I was calcium deficient despite the fact that I eat tons of aged cheese, I eat canned fish with bones in it, I eat lots of raw milk. I was still deficient in calcium. I have actually some of these supplements at eatbeautiful.net/resources. Most of these supplements are there if you want to look at like these actual brands, because this is the only calcium that I would recommend that I know of that's trustworthy that absorbs really well. And that's what we're talking about here is absorption and cofactors. But anyways, ask your practitioner. I'm just telling you what some things that have been essential for me. So in addition to some of those basics like D3, K2, magnesium, the other supplements that I want to mention are one, pathogen killers. And again, her book really isn't about pathogen killers. It is about gut dysbiosis, which means, you know, the uneven ratio of candida to good flora. And we're, you know, so much of her book is about putting good flora back into your gut and how do you do that and how do you do it gently and effectively and which probiotics to choose, whether it be food or supplements. But there isn't a lot on pathogen killers and how to kill either candida overgrowth or just other kinds of pathogens that have overgrown in your system. So that became really important for me. I do have a couple posts on my blog about pathogen overgrowth, so you can type those into the search engine if you're interested. I will just like flash before the screen a few quick ones. We have oregano essential oil, which you don't want to do too much of, but up to 6 weeks of that one is way better than antibiotics. Olive leaf extract, cat's claw, pau d'arco. There's so many, and again, if you go to eatbeautiful.net/resources, there's several all in a row. Above them all is another supplement that ended up being key. Do you remember how I mentioned that my gut still hadn't healed? I still had painful leaky gut after 4 years on GAPS. Well, this little supplement is the one I discovered that ended up healing that leaky gut, and it is N-acetyl-L-cysteine. This is actually a really inexpensive brand. It has a teeny bit of rice flour in it, but we're doing fine with it. But there are other brands that you can look at. I think I have a link to a different brand on my site because I wouldn't want to recommend the rice flour one to everybody. But I now have all my kids and I on it because it has been so effective and so important. This supplement is not only something that helps to rebuild your gut lining, it also breaks through the biofilm of pathogens, which is why I mentioned it in conjunction with the pathogen killers. That's how I first discovered it, as I started taking it to break through the biofilm so that these herbs would penetrate and kill the pathogens. But what I didn't realize at the time is that N-acetyl-L-cysteine is an amino acid that is a precursor to glutathione, which is necessary for rebuilding the gut lining. And so my gut healed and sealed for the first time when I was on this, and that wasn't even what I was targeting at the time. And I think this is really an under-discussed supplement that's fantastic. I highly recommend it. It comes in 600 to 900 milligrams. I started with 900 with a different brand, and now I do 600 milligrams a day. As with all supplements, they're not necessarily meant to be taken indefinitely. Something especially like N-acetyl-L-cysteine is an amino acid. That means it's not a whole food. So just keep that in mind. Talk to your practitioner about it. I just want to mention it so that you're aware. Let me see where I am here with time. Excuse me. Okay, I'm going to mention one more and then we'll finish up next week. And please feel free to throw in any questions you may have. So the last one I'm going to mention today, you know what, I wanted to mention too, as part of the supplements, minerals, fulvic ionic minerals. So basically soil minerals, the minerals that used to be in our soil, that used to be prevalent in our vegetables and in our water that are no longer there, especially if you're using a purifier. Adding back in minerals is key. So like when my son, who I believe is on right now, giving me hearts, when he goes to basketball practice, if he has a really hard workout and we don't add minerals to his water, he'll get a really bad headache. And that's again because, look, we're still getting well. We're still nutrient deficient. We are not in perfect shape, and we need to make sure to be putting back into our bodies what our bodies need for the basic functions to be performed, so we don't want to deplete our system. So just like a lot of people talk about electrolyte beverages, and you know, they're putting in the little bit of sea salt, the apple cider vinegar, the honey, great. Don't forget that your body needs soil minerals on a daily basis. Okay, final item that I'm going to mention, and that is food intolerances. Someone says, thank you for all your information. I was low in magnesium. What magnesium spray do you use? You're welcome. And I use this Omica one, or Omica, sorry, is probably how it's pronounced. I don't actually know. Omica. And it's with biodynamic lavender. I love this one for so many reasons. This is about $15. It lasts me about 6 months. It lasts so long. The best thing about this is it's not sticky. So if you make your own, or if you buy the one that comes up right away, if you type in magnesium oil on Amazon, you'll get one that's like, I can't remember what it's called, but it's the main one, magnesium oil spray, and it's sticky. And so like my son, who doesn't like, you know, tags and things, it drives him nuts. Whereas this one, I mean, he's not gonna like love it, but it's not, it's wonderful. It absorbs right in, it smells like lavender, and it lasts forever. So it's a teeny bit more money. This is 15, and I think the other one might be 11. But so this is the one that I recommend, O-M-I-C-A. And there is a link to it at eatbeautiful.net/resources. Ancient Minerals, yeah. The other brand is Ancient Minerals. And I'm sure it's just as effective, but however this one is formulated, I can tell you for sure it's completely effective because I have leg spasms when I don't use it, and I don't when I do. But it doesn't have that sticky sensation. I kind of enjoy it actually. It feels like it's part of my like little ritual, getting ready for bed or waking up in the morning. And partially because it comes in a pretty bottle. It's glass. I love that. Okay, last item is food intolerances. We hear a lot. Do I use melatonin? We'll have to talk about that next week because I'm afraid I'm not going to get to everything that I wanted to talk to you today. But please, please bring that up again next week and we'll talk about adrenals and sleep issues. Thanks. So as far as food intolerances, we talk a lot about food allergies, and sometimes we use the word food allergies interchangeably with food intolerances. There was a man who lived about 100 years ago. He was a naturopathic doctor named Dr. Otis Carroll. He was building off the research of two other doctors that came before him, and he developed this insight into, on a cellular level, this concept of food intolerances. And his assertion, which I believe because I've seen it work out in my body and in my daughter's life, specifically, is that everybody has a food intolerance, sometimes more than one. And if you're in good health and your body's detoxing, you're getting lots of natural vitamin D from sunlight, you may never need to know what that food intolerance is because it doesn't matter. Your body's detoxing and it's digesting foods great. For those of us who have compromised health and problems with detoxification, problems with digestion, what our food intolerance is extremely important. Now, I'll tell you, so they're big food groups a lot of the time. So, like for me, mine is fruit. My doctor, Dr. Zeff, up in Vancouver, Washington, did a blood evaluation and I found out mine was fruit. It gave me the biggest light bulb moment because I thought I was having die-off. Like, I thought I was having 4 years of die-off. Because every time I would eat, like, grain-free pancakes with blackberries or have an apple or whatever, every time I ate fruit, I felt horrible afterwards. Like my arms were really heavy and I'd have to go take a nap. And if I had to work, I just had to drag myself through for like an hour and a half till it worked itself off. And I thought it was die-off. All these years, I thought it was die-off, which is basically, I thought I was like somehow feeding candida and then it was dying after I was eating. I didn't really understand the process. All I knew was that's what I thought was going on. Well, even things like olives and cardamom, coriander, even hibiscus are fruits in our bodies. And when I eliminated all of those, I never had that feeling ever again. It was gone. In addition to that, I was able to put my bladder disease called interstitial cystitis into remission, and basically just make huge progress overall with my healing. In my daughter's case, her food intolerance is dairy, and he was able to put her asthma into remission by removing dairy. So this evaluation is so insightful. It's not, the IgG or IgA food allergy test. It's totally different. It's not a test, it's an evaluation. He can do it through the mail. If you're interested in this, for us, it was just key. I'm not sure it made a huge difference in my youngest son's health. I can't tell yet. We just implemented his. His food intolerances are actually eggs and honey. So we've only been doing those for a short time with him, and it's hard for me to tell for sure the ma any major change with him. But for my daughter and I, it made a huge difference. If you're interested in reading more about it, I have two posts on my blog that talk about it, and then there's a link to this doctor if you want to call. You can actually get the evaluation through the mail and send it back to him. And so let's see, my asthma post and my interstitial cystitis post. So if you were go to the search engine and type in asthma, the one about my daughter will come up, or if you type in interstitial cystitis, if you can figure out how to spell it, the one about my bladder disease will come up. Both of those talk about the evaluation, and there's a link to his office. And I see a lot of clients that call, so they'll know why you're calling if you ask to receive that in the mail. The evaluation is $150. I don't benefit in any way if you choose to do that, but I highly recommend it if you are someone that's wrestling with, there being some kind of a hurdle in your way, something that's sabotaging your health, then this very well might be, gates that open for you so you're able to move forward. So for us, it was a really big deal. And again, so that's the difference between a food evaluation, I'm sorry, a food intolerance and a food allergy. Dr. Otis Carroll and my doctor, Dr. Zeff, would say a food allergy is something you can outgrow, even like a really, really serious peanut allergy. Under the right circumstances, you can outgrow that. But a food intolerance is something that your body natively just inherently cannot digest. And so by removing it, we then improve digestion. By improving digestion, we allow our bodies to get well because that's the thought, right? That our digestion is the foundation of all wellness. Okay, I'm going to stop there for today, and then next week we'll do part two of my additions to the GAPS diet. If you'd like to see this video later on, you can go to my YouTube channel, which is Megan Stevens. If you'd like to subscribe to my Periscope channel and have the opportunity to watch me live on Wednesdays, that is at Meg Eat Beautiful. My handle is at Meg Eat Beautiful. And if you're interested in seeing any of these supplements again, you can go to eatbeautiful.net/resources and read more about those products. Okay, any other questions that you want to squeeze in? Thanks everybody for tuning in. I am Megan Stevens with eatbeautiful.net, and thanks so much. I hope you have a wonderful week. Bye.